All right, hello, internet. Hello. I like that, hello. I'm Johnny Jungle Guts, the top-notch gamer, aka the top-notch gay-mer. And I'm here today with William Johnson Jr., aka Willyouarenot.
Hi-o.
He's a DJ.
Wiki wiki scratch.
He runs the club, and he's gonna help me run this Final Fantasy 6 today.
Which is too dope.
Which is too dope.
I'm actually a very huge Final Fantasy fan.
Yes.
So of course, when I was asked, I had to say yes.
Thank you so much for coming in. What am I doing? You were on Strategy Guide. What am I supposed to be doing
but
first
wait,
here?
This is for Final Fantasy 3.
Yes, but when they originally released this in the States, they called it Final Fantasy 3 because she didn't want to release a bunch of the other ones, so it's technically 6.
Facts.
Yes. Little known piece of information.
So then we're talking about castle keepsakes.
Yes.
Saying explore the castle. This is a good general advice, but in this case, there are some things you really need. In one room, you'll find a shopkeeper selling Edgar's special tools. Buy them. Check every chest. Stock up on tonic. Also buy at least one phoenix down, which means you're gonna die.
Yeah, okay, let's find the shop here. Oh my goodness.
My favorite is the soundtrack. It just reminds me of like all the things Final Fantasy, and like even when you listen to like the newer ones, like you still hear that kind of like
that faint
reminder of like all the fantasies past.
All the ones past. Because they all have the same sort of like prelude theme music when you're booting up and starting the game and stuff like that.
Yeah,
that. That's like almost like a Philip Glass, like super experimental type jam that they're like working with.
I actually just got the Final Fantasy VII and Final Fantasy X piano soundtracks.
Beautiful.
And then I got the Final Fantasy VII. Like, it's like an 8-bit, like, I guess it was on 8-bit Collective, and it was like an 8-bit, like, remix of the whole, like, soundtrack. And then there's, like, this remix album that's called Black Materia that has, like, all these people that came together and made all these collective tracks.
So yeah.
It's pretty dope.
Got some phoenix down, that's good.
And you bought all the tools and checked all the chests. Mm-hmm. I love how it even tells you that it's like vague.
Wait, I don't think I did. I know. I don't think I did buy all the tools. Okay, 500 and okay. So she's gonna need to go buy, get some, go kill some monsters, and make some money.
So you're like not even that far in the game, right?
No. We are an hour in. Okay. We are just getting fired up, which makes the gameplay a little tedious. But that will.
It's trying to teach you how to do everything.
Yeah, it's trying to do the conveyance.
Yeah. Come on, chocobo.
Okay, let's see. What is her life situation here right now?
She's like, she's gonna die.
Yeah, she's okay. She's okay. We could get a little bit going before you have to go to the end here.
Uh-oh.
So now, Will, how did you get into the DJ game exactly?
I guess it all started when I met this DJ Black Rainbow named Sarah Toon. She's like the booking manager at The Lash.
Okay.
And it was Art Walk that night, and another group of people that I worked with that are like friends of mine, Dolls House Productions, were doing, it was called Full Set. It was an Art Walk party. Mm-hmm. And so I got to meet her, and I just said, hey, I've always wanted to do something like this, like throw a party. And she was like, yeah, sure, who did you want to DJ? And I was like, well, I mean, I don't really know any DJs, and they were like, why don't you just DJ it?
Ooh.
And I was like, oh, well, how would I go about that? And so Z Baron, one of the other managers, if you will, at The Lash, he made it pretty clear that I could just like burn some tracks onto a couple CDs and things and just like, you know, get on the CDJs and make it happen. So
yes.
That was 2 years ago, almost two and like 3 months now. And so since then, I've thrown everything, a single kind of party you can think of. Like I even did like an Italo disco party. I have like, you know, acid, like deep house, disco, trap. Like even now I'm starting to play for Mustache Mondays. I just moved there, and that's like a pretty big deal because they're like downtown LA, like royalty or whatever. So
yes,
yeah. So naturally we go. See, I told you you're gonna die.
Oh, That was pathetic. That was so pathetic.
It's just because it's the start.
I didn't have a lot of options there.
It's the start. Like,
that, well, because there's only one of me right now. The one of me got paralyzed, and then I couldn't run away. Oh.
Well, did you get everything inside?
No, that's why I was going out there to do that, because I was paranoid. I didn't buy the bio blaster yet. So I need to get that bio blaster. But if there's only one of me, you know what? I think there's a later section right after this next piece where we can still go in the castle and shop.
Are you willing to risk it?
Well, I don't really want to, no. Okay, this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna go to, this is gonna be so...
Just circulating the whole
thing. This is gonna be so much.
You have to do it.
We're just gonna be walking all around.
Yeah.
And then...
Just check it out.
Just do it. And then I'm just gonna save after every battle in case I get turned into...
That's the smart way to do it.
Okay, oh. Magic.
Phew!
There we go. That's what I'm trying to do. Okay. See, but now he's doing that. And I'm numb. Now I'm numb.
No.
So she's just trapped. This is what happened to me the last time. Whatever, that's paralyzed.
This is a sick situation.
This is not... See, like, how am I supposed to cope with this?
You're dead.
No. I think she's going to snap out of it.
Usually it's three turns.
Just in time.
They've only had one.
She's going to snap out of it. Oh, well, now he's trying to get her on that again. Oh.
No, even like in the newer ones, you can't be like over numbed or like over paralyzed. Once it happens, everybody else
come on,
it.
Snap out of it, honey.
No, three turns.
You can do it. You can do it.
Three turns.
You can do it. Yes.
There you go.
Yes.
But is that gonna kill him?
No.
No. You're dead.
Oh my gosh, this is disgraceful.
Yeah. No, not even. At the beginning of any Final Fantasy game, you're dying left and right.
Oh my gosh. Mm-hmm.
Even half the time, you think about people that actually spend like the first... As soon as you get into a battle system, they spend like the first 30 minutes doing as much of that system as they can. Just get those experience points and just keep going. There's people that spend like hours in the same area until they're like the emperor, like master of that entire area.
Okay,
I really
want that bio blaster though. That's what I need.
Did you check to see if there's like any like hidden treasure chest that might have money in it? Oh, around.
That's a good question.
Like
let's look around.
Doors and
let's
stuff.
Look around just a little bit.
You
see if there's something. Okay,
out.
That's. Okay, oh, you know what? This is what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna sell some of these other items if that's an option.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, don't need 24 potions, I'm gonna say. Okay, that's getting us a little bit there. Mithril nut. Okay, we need that.
Like, yeah, don't give up anything crazy. A sleeping bag, maybe? Because you have four.
I do have a bunch.
And that was 250.
Oh, I'm doing... Okay.
Yeah, I think you're pretty good now.
Okay, let's see if I've got enough. Oh, my gosh. Too much multitasking. I'm getting tweeted at. I'm just trying to get this noise blaster and bio blaster. Okay.
Now you can get both.
Yes. Okay,
Bye.
That's a strategy.
Didn't you even have to die.
You just gotta get your money right. You don't need to fight monsters.
Didn't even
you just
have to die.
Need to sell.
You died twice for no reason. Luckily, it won't go down in history.
It will go down on YouTube a little bit, I'm afraid.
Hey. The viewers will know.
There are worse things.
The gameplay
weren't. The game, yeah. Okay, let's see what this guy has to say. I like your castle a lot, buddy.
Uh oh, here we go. Look at his hair.
Ooh, that music. Oh, here comes. Ooh.
I know, he's like
glamorous.
Here. Ooh, he's about to attack.
What does it say?
Kefka, yeah? Kefka's
yes,
attack.
Yeah.
On orders from Emperor Gestal, Kefka has crossed the desert to see if Terra has fled to Castle Figaro. When Edgar approaches, he must talk to the guards first, then Kefka. Edgar's answer won't satisfy the madman, and the castle will be torched, setting up your daring escape by Chocobo.
Okay.
Oh gosh. I should have said teaser, I guess. I'm not sure how
to deal. I mean... Oh, sand in the boots? You don't want that.
You're getting blown up.
Out of the boots.
The evil laugh.
What in the world brings you out of my way? Oh, I'm sure he doesn't talk like that.
I just love seeing how old school, like...
He seems like kind of a little gay, let's be honest.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not the. Okay.
Let's see.
Who you been busy
first? You have to talk to the guards, then him. See, oh, he's the strategy, like, gave you everything.
He's like, he can't even speak to you. He's too above it.
Oop.
I thought it was a pretty nice castle, honestly. Gosh. I thought it looked good.
He's angry.
Witch, in parentheses.
We know. Magic.
Because in this, magic doesn't even really exist right now.
No, yeah.
They're like trying to reverse engineer it. They're trying to figure out how it works.
Yeah.
That's the plot here.
Well, when you go through the Final Fantasies, even the early ones, there's always that progression of, like, magic and spells, and, like, even the, like, sorcery and, like, witches. Like, it just becomes classes. It's like everyone saw the battle system coming, like, you know?
And there's, like, yeah. There's a lot of times there's, like, you sort of, like, sacrifice something to do magic, like in Final Fantasy VIII, how they all, since they've been using those guardian forces, they all have lost their memory, kind of.
Yeah. And the whole cards and blah blah thing.
Yeah.
Final Fantasy VIII was cool. Like, I liked it, but I mean,
but,
I was in it more for the story.
Yeah.
Seven was where I was at.
Seven is pretty clutch.
Yeah, I'm ready for this remake. Like, come on.
Being a king is not all tea and crumpets.
Tea and crumpets.
That sounds kind of good, actually.
A crumpet? Give me a bit of a win. I know, and even in the beginning, it's like the advancement of story is pretty serious, like, because you're just like talking, you're just pushing A the whole time, you're reading a whole bunch of story, but it's like good story.
Okay, he definitely went this way though. I'm gonna say,
let's see.
Okay, now I'm just walking straight out of the map here. Where does it say to go after he leaves? Who do I go talk to? Is John even telling us?
Have to keep walking through.
I have to keep talking to people. Okay. I feel like I saw him go. There's all these prisoners down here. So when you started DJing, you were DJing on what? CD? You said CD bass?
Pioneer 2000 and their Nexus, which I'm just coming to find out is kind of like the real deal.
Oh, yeah?
Not saying I'm like.
So,
lost user or anything.
So, I mean, that goes without saying. So, you're DJing on CDs, essentially?
Well, at this point, I've progressed to, like, having, like, a USB drive with, like, all of my tracks on it.
And even
at this point now, you can, like, there's this, like, software called Recordbox.
Okay.
That, like, sorts everything down specifically for, like, devices such as, like, CDJs and, like, controllers and things of that nature.
Okay.
So, it's, like, even now, I'll just, like, make a playlist, like, on iTunes. Like, I have tons of music. Like, I can't even begin to tell you how much music I have. Like, there's beyond gigs. I have 2 terabyte drives already. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I mean? And it's, like, music from, like, back in the days. Like, all the stuff I've ever had, like, from the internet across the days. Like, you know, any DJ's collection is, like, you know, it's huge. Whatever. But even as I'm, like, sorting it down and, like, getting tracks that I want to play for any specific party, it's, like, I just end up with these playlists of, like, 400... maybe like 300 songs.
Yeah.
And I'll like do that like a week before a party and I'll just listen to all the tracks and like I'll start like, of course I'll put it on my iPhone and I'll just start like hearting all the tracks and like, okay, I like this one, I like this one, I'm gonna play this one, I'm gonna play this one. Then I'll go through it one more time and break it down to anywhere between like 100 songs or to at least like 4 or 5 hours worth of music.
Okay.
Like mix stuff up. You know?
For how long of a set?
Well, that just depends. Like even if it's for an hour, like as long as I have like a whole bunch of music, like, I feel more comfortable, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I think it just depends on, like, the venue or, like, the people that are going to be there or, like, what kind of party. Like, anytime I'm playing, like, a trap party, like, I know I can do, like, 60 songs and get away with it.
Wow.
You know, like, as I'm going to play those tracks out and, of course, like, people want to hear, like, the boom boom beats that come, like, to the end of the front, whatever. Or even if it's, like, a song that has, like, 4 different rappers on it, they really want to hear that track, I'll play it out. Like, you know, I'll play it out. But most DJs these days, at least the ones I know in my circle, we don't play out like a whole track. I think I'm one of the few that actually plays out like most of the track.
Most of the
but that's
record.
You know, I just appreciate a lot of music. So usually I walk in with about 100, 100, maybe like 100 something songs. Anytime I do like a house party, it's way more than that. Way more than that. Because I like to like mix tracks together. Because, you know, you can like beat match or do like BPMs. Or if you know your set really well, like practice. So it just depends on the night.
And it, the vibe when you, like, just on the vibe you will, it'll affect what you want to play. You don't know till that moment.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh my gosh. Yeah, totally. And then as you go off like what the people are like dancing to, and like this last Monday I played Massage and we ended up going into like a 45 minute like dance hall like back to back like set out of
nowhere. Oh my gosh.
And I was just like, I'm glad I have all these dance hall songs on me right now. Cause me and the other DJ, Steven, he's like on point, and like he was just like, I heard you play dance hall, and I was like, alright, like let's play a track, like let's see where it goes. So I dropped like Sean Paul or something, like Get Busy. Next thing you know, packed, lit. So many people. It was ridiculous. It, like, the walls were sweating. I was wearing a trench coat and a hoodie. I was just like, who am I? I thought I was in the Matrix.
Oh my god.
Yeah, it was great.
My shit is on fire right now.
Yeah, you torched it down.
Okay.
And this is your daring escape by Chocobo.
Yes, okay, so let's get into that.
And I'm like, is this gonna be where they have, like, a Super Supreme cutscene or what?
Yeah. Get her ready.
Lure up.
Change of heart. Oh man! I bet when this happened on Super Nintendo, people were like, wow. He just jumped that. Yeah, I think you're right. I think it was good that we got that stuff before we bounced.
Right. Because you're gone.
It's like a
it was real serious.
Transformer castle.
Dive mode.
Remember Final Fantasy 9, there was a castle that like came to life now, like,
oh yeah,
or something like that.
Totally.
Seems slightly related to that.
Well, like in Final Fantasy 7, there was like the Temple of the Ancients that like ended up being all linked up with Sephiroth, or Final Fantasy 10, it was well, yeah, I guess so.
I mean, in that, it was like all a dream or whatever.
Yeah. Well.
Oh, sorry. I don't want to ruin it for you. I want to keep talking.
No. I've played it so many times. I know, but it just makes me hard.
I know. I just read this piece in, I think it was, Art Forum. Mm-hmm. And it was Hari Neff wrote it. Do you know Hari Neff? She's like a trans model. She was the first trans model ever signed to IMG Models.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But she was, it was like a top 10 or something like that, her favorite things. And one of them was like Final Fantasy X. And she said after she beat that game, she's like, I've never been in love, but after I beat that game, I wept. God.
Tears.
Absolutely.
I love mid battle, like.
Oh yeah, we're just breaking into dialogue. I think they're like mad that she, like they're confused that she knows how to do magic. That's like, what's going on?
Yeah,
I like that these two are just like chilling while this is going
not
on.
Killing anybody.
They can't be bothered.
I mean, I would have slashed the back by now.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
She's discovering herself.
Please. I can do all these tricks with my hands. This is like the descendant of like all the mages who were like depressed about, you know, across the lines, like Eris depressed.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, definitely some angst there.
What's her name from 8? The main chick.
Renoa.
Yeah.
She was a mess.
Just dumb.
Eris was like a burst of flowers compared to her.
Yeah, but she was still like. You know,
she was a little bit of a mess. Yeah.
Some type of way.
Yeah.
And then, 9, there was that little old school sorcerer guy with a little, like, Mickey hat.
Oh, yeah, he was mad. He was real depressed.
10, it was Lulu. She was always just so
she was like the god.
Yeah, the god. Because, baby.
She was my favorite. She was one of my favorite characters in that. Her and Orin, I really liked.
Yeah.
Final Fantasy. Yeah. Ooh, high potion, that's nice.
took away realness.
Escapes.
They're
like doing laps.
Son of a sandworm. Come on, bandit way. The returners. Her face, it says it all. Like, the magic sucks my soul. Black magic user. She's like, I'm not
She's
human.
Like, what?
Oh my god, I can't.
She can't take it.
Then you turn the page. Then you wash your hands. Let's see. I always forget, like, the older ones, you have, like, hella characters.
Oh, yeah, there's, like, 10 plus characters in this.
Yeah. Alright, so South Figaro. Your escape before the chocobos is challenged by Kefka's guard, the Magitech armor. After thrashing the fools, continue east to the mountains and look for a cave entrance. Hop off your bird and enter the cave. Be sure to stop at the pool to restore your energy levels, then continue to the cave, battling the many monsters within. When you emerge, you'll be near the town of South Figaro.
This looks like a cave entrance to me. How do I dismount? There we
go. Yeah.
Oh no, that's a town. Oh well. We'll get through it.
Now you're getting some
experience. Wait, where did it say? Wait, where did it say the cave entrance was?
Continue east to the mountains.
East, okay.
Mm-hmm. Oh, crossbow. That was like a bunny eating.
Yeah, it's kind of cruel that we were taking out, we're just out and taking out bunnies.
Oh, wow.
Cave to the east. So, tell the children out here on the internet, what is Mustache Mondays exactly?
What is Mustache Mondays? Let me count the
words. I mean, exactly is probably a bad word to even use.
No, not exactly. No, I think the most beautiful and illustrious thing about Mustache Mondays is that it's a culmination of people with a common bond, and that common bond is to bring all things queer, weird, unnormal, underground, lit as fuck, like
all
the beautiful stuff under one roof, and just make it sweaty and as raunchy as possible.
Yes.
I think Nacho, who's like Nacho Nava, he's like one of the original founders. Of course, there's Josh Bees, and there's tons of names we could spit out if you want to talk about Mustache. But
sure.
It's like, even at where it's at now, like when even somebody like me is involved, too. I went to Mustache like 5 years ago. My coworker Marcus took me, like, was just like, come with me, I want you to meet Josh. We had already been going to like Mr. Black's, and like Josh Bishina, he's like legendary house DJ, LA, we know you, come on Josh, we love you. Like, he was at Mustache, and I was like, okay, well, what's this place? What's La Cita? And like, I'm born and raised in LA, so like, I've always passed by La Cita, but I never knew like things of this nature went down. So like, even when I went, it was just like, oh, these people. And at that time, that was like, I guess they were like 5 years in already.
Yeah, it's been around a while.
Like, it's,
how long do you think it's been around?
They just had the 8-year anniversary, or 9? I don't know. It's
pretty amazing for a party to last.
It already seems like forever. Like, you know what I mean? Like, even for me, who's like only been in it for so long, and even now to just be DJing it is like a really big deal. You know, like, even just like,
yeah,
just playing my tracks for the people. Like, I've always wanted to be in that situation. So it's pretty cool. So I mean, anybody that wants to go, it's now at The Lash, which is also the place that I use all the time.
Yes.
117 Winston Street in downtown.
Plug it.
Yeah, I know. Sarah's like, yeah, Ross is like, that's my boy. No, yeah, like, it's a beautiful place. It's a wonderful venue. Mondays, it's usually Mustache. There is a cover, but come early and promise you'll enjoy yourself, and the drinks are on point. And
they are, and
like,
they're pretty
the
cheap.
The music is always...
always amazing.
Always lit.
Always really good.
Super lit. Like, oh my god. Even for me, myself, who was part of that Flame and Fuego, like, no, please. It's so long. So what the hell is that? It's like a caterpillar, like
Yurok.
It's like laying its own eggs or something.
I don't know what's going on. Oh wait, look in the back. There might be a bestiary. It might tell us if there's anything it's weak
against. Bestiary. Yeah, Kurok, baby.
I think it's called. Let's see. Yurok. You are okay.
Poodles. Oh gosh, charge you guys like this, like.
It's old.
This is so real.
It's they've definitely perfected the art of strategy guides after this
moment.
At
this point, yeah. Like, but oh my gosh, this is so real. I had one for like Taken 2. Tomb Raider 1, 2, and 3. Okay. Of course. My sister actually had the PlayStation. I always had. My very first system was obviously NES. Like, we had an Atari, but I wasn't about that life. And then, I got a Sega Genesis. I used to go to my friend's house to play Super Nintendo. And that got real because we used to play, what's it called? Northbound?
I don't even know that game. Tell me about that.
Is it Northbound?
Earthbound.
Earth, there we go, yeah.
Yes.
Whew. Let me tell you about getting older. Let's start forgetting these things.
Well, Earthbound has been,
Did they, like, remake it yet? No.
They haven't remade it, but many of the big indie games of today cite Earthbound as a very big influence, I think.
Yeah, totally.
Especially this new game that just came out, Undertale, which everyone has been telling me I should play.
That sounds so gay.
It looked a little gay. I mean, the premise of it was, like, the RPG where you don't have to kill anybody. Which is cute. I like that.
I mean,
non-violence.
Everything a little gay these days.
Everything's a little gay.
We just have to incorporate our beauty everywhere.
Yes, we do. How old were you when you realized the gay was strong in you? If we want to get into that.
Realized?
I mean, that's a complicated question.
That is a complicated question because I mean, I was always a really effeminate boy as it was, like
sure.
Even as I'm like 6'7". My voice is what it is, you know, I'm very bravado these days, if you want to call it that. But, like, as a child, I was always confused for my sister, like, constantly. Like, you know what I mean? And I guess I played with, like, semi-masculine toys and, like, did boy things. Like, I played sports. We definitely did, like, basketball, football for a little bit, like, you know. And I never
football.
Was, like, yeah, just a little bit. Like,
little
I,
bit,
I
yeah.
wasn't really about that. Like,
dabbled.
Like, you know what I mean? I was... very non-violent MLK, like, you know, child. And, like, I never really, like, noticed, like, the guys in the locker room or something like that. Cause we were just kids.
Yeah.
We were always at home, or we always did things, like, in the family. So, I think it was when I first moved back to LA from the Valley that I realized, like, okay, yeah, like, your gay is all out. I need to, like, butch it up. You know what I mean? Because in LA, like, people eat your life, especially kids. That was
back in
95, 96, 97.
It's like, such a different world.
And then even before high school, it was like too much. So, and my dad was like a cop, and he was one of those like, you know, you're not gonna be a bitch kind of parents, you know? So
yeah.
For me, I was like, no, I'm not gonna be. I dated girls and everything. Like, that's not
good.
The very first time I ever had like feelings for like a boy was like in fourth grade. I went to this school called Wildflower Elementary, and I had a best friend who lived in the trailer parks, like, right up the street.
Mm-hmm.
His name was Craig, and, he had bug teeth like me, and he was kind of tall, and he had, like, really cute hair, and we used to always just play, like, games. Like, I would literally walk to his house after school, because I was a latchkey kid, so, you know, I was like, fuck my parents.
Yeah, you can do whatever you want.
Off at work, and do whatever the hell I want. And so, I'd go over his house, and we'd play, like, fucking Final Fantasy, and, like, watch Tiny Toons and eat PB&J sandwiches with bananas and shit.
Everything you
and,
want.
Like, he was at the trailer park, so like his mom was like forever at work. Like
right.
It would get dark before I would head home, and my parents wouldn't even say anything, you know, because they wouldn't get home until like 8. And I think it was one time, like, and he like pissed on himself at school. Or
oh my gosh!
And I was Mr. Peabody myself. Like that's something I like, you know, even to this day. Like whatever, it was true. But like we like always had like that kind of like common bond or whatever. And so we went back to his house, and he was like crying because like somebody had saw him, and like you know back then, you know, being a Peabody is a fetish.
Yeah.
So nowadays it's like a fetish we all get into.
Yeah.
So yeah, like he like, we went to his house and I was like, it's gonna be fine, dude. Like, I totally, like, wet the bed, like, you know, so he's like, no.
Oh my gosh, I totally did.
You know? So he, like, started stripping.
Oh boy.
To, like, take a shower.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I just...
Remind me the age again. What's the age here?
Oh my god.
Little
boys. It has to be, like, 8.
Yeah.
Maybe 7.
And you knew you were gay then.
Yeah.
Like, you already were, like, covering up. You were covering, like, up.
Yeah.
When you said, you know, when you moved back and you had to start covering up, I thought, like, 12 maybe. But 8, you already knew 8.
I moved back to L.A. at 13.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I was in 7th grade. And I had been, like, we lived in Palmdale. Like, literally, we were, like, one of the only black girls for, like, 5 miles.
Yeah.
So I had tons of friends. Tons of friends. Got invited to sleepovers, like, all of that.
Because you were the only black family?
Yeah, like, no, like, really, like,
what's
I had
that
friends,
about?
I had friends that were just like, no, man, like, you're cool, like, one time my friend that was, like, up the street, he was like, dude, I wanted to be friends with you since the day you came to our school, like, it was second grade, and, like, you were the only, like, tall kid in class just like me, but, like, you're black, and I was just like, what does that even mean, like, as a kid?
Right,
like,
exactly, yeah. Like,
and I thought I was, like, just normal, but then as soon as I, like, came back to 7th grade and I went to Mid-City Magnet, which is, like, in, like, I lived in the hood, of course, so it was, like, rough, but it was, like, no, like, I really got, like, a false reminder, like, okay, you are a faggot, like, calm down, like, please calm down, like, you will get your ass beat. And
oh,
I was, like,
God,
depressed because my parents had, like, divorced, so I was, like, an emotional eater at that point, so I was, like,
oh, boy.
So, like, people were already picking on me and stuff.
Oh, that's
brutal.
So,
it was, like, yeah, it was bad. Yeah, I was a little ugly. But, yeah, like, it was, yeah, he stripped and...
Right, oh, yeah, back to that.
He was, like, getting in the shower and, like, he was the kind of, like, not really, like, a chunky boy, but, like, he was, like...
I mean, nothing wrong with that.
He had, like, a lot of booty, you know what I mean? And,
yes.
Like, I was about that life. So, yeah, it was good.
And that was really, like, you
yeah,
knew,
like,
deep down.
Like, we made out. Like, we
Oh, like...
Like, as soon as he got in the shower, like, I walked in, and he was like, do you want to take a shower with me?
Oh,
and I was
gosh.
Like, yes. And it got... Because, I mean, we were both, like... We had both, like, been in the locker rooms before and stuff, and, like, you know, like, but our lockers were, like, right next to each other. Like, we were best friends.
Mm-hmm.
But even at that point, it was just kind of, like... I don't know. We didn't think it was weird. But then, like, yeah... He kissed me.
Right.
And I, like, thought it was really weird, but I, like, didn't stop.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember it because it was, like, I specifically remember, like, why aren't you stopping? Like, what's going on? And then, like, not even, like, maybe, like, 2 months after that, my dad, like, had, like, a case. Like, he beat the crap out of, like, some gay dude. And, like, he said all this shit at, like, home. And, like...
Your father?
Real. Yeah, my dad. Oh, yeah, no. My dad was one of those cops. He was one of those cops, definitely. And so I always had that history of, like, okay, like, I don't, you know, I don't want to be involved with anything dealing with, like, that, or, like, stuff that's going to get me in trouble. So.
Wow, so
yeah,
self-aware.
I had to, like, keep it in wraps.
So self-aware.
I had to keep it in wraps. So, like, I dated girls, like, you have no idea, like, I did the damn thing. Come on, Shadow.
Shadow, I've been naming.
So you do get to rename, like.
You do.
You do.
And I'm naming all these characters. This is serious. I have never beaten this game, and I've probably played through the first, like, 2/3 of it, like, way too many times to not have beaten it, like, throughout my life. So, and every time I play it, I always name it after, like, all my friends. So,
yeah.
This time I'm naming it after, like, friends from, like, my whole life.
Right.
So this is my friend Sachin, the Kadani, shout out to Sachin. He was my roommate sophomore in high school, and he was so cool. He put me on to all kinds of... sort of like 60s counterculture stuff, and he used to like play the sitar, and I would like read poems over it. All kinds of ridiculous hippie stuff going on in the woods of Pennsylvania. But he was a real loner, and so was this guy, Shadow,
yeah.
So that's why.
There it is.
There's the match.
Wow.
Wait, what does it say we're supposed to do? We've gone through this.
You went
we
to
did,
the cave.
We, wait, run through the items checklist for me real quick.
So,
there's like a little list right here.
Let's see. Tunnel armor. Recovery strength.
Did that.
Door.
Went through the door.
Tincture.
Oh, I got one tincture. I mean, who really needs a tincture?
One, and then a phoenix down.
Phoenix down. The tunnel armor, though, where is that on the
tunnel
map?
Tunnel armor.
Where are we seeing that?
Is right before you hit the desert.
Oh, that's like right at the door of it.
Yeah.
Because there's the water right there. Okay, let me just go. First let me heal a little bit, and then I'm gonna go see if I can go back.
Yeah, hit that pool, friend. Don't get crazy.
Okay. I know you're trying to tell me something, but I'm just trying to take a nap right now. Buddy. I am always amazed when I hear these stories of, like, my boyfriend, like, being your that age and going over like someone's house like and watch it was like we watched South Park, which we weren't supposed to, and I like touched his butt or something like that. Like, I never had the audacity to go there as like a kid, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I didn't even—
well, that's because you're classy.
Well,
I'm a dork. I was born to be a whore. Like, that's like my dad's like destiny for me. He was always like, son, you're gonna be the greatest pimp this world has ever seen. Like, he would tell me shit like that.
Little did he know.
Would wake up. And little does he know, like, as to this day, as I am his own, like, yeah. I mean, that's, you know. Now, like, touching somebody on the butt, that's not a big deal.
No way.
Know what I mean? Like, there's go-go boys that are, like, you know, getting all kinds of stuff like that. But it's like, back then, oh no. Like, had to be behind closed doors, had to be in secret. Like, even as a kid, you knew, like, because if you got caught, like, imagine.
Yeah.
I never got caught. Like, my family knew. I feel like even now, it's like me and my mom and everybody talks about it. Like, they knew. But it's like not something they were ready to talk about then, you know?
Yeah. I hear you.
So, there you go.
Because like, I wasn't even, well, I guess it was like 7th or 8th grade. So you still have not really talked about it with your mom?
Oh, no, no. We're cool now. Oh, no, everybody knows.
But now they know.
My God, no. Like, my dad, he can't even handle it. And then me and my mom, like, my mom's destiny for me is that I'm going to get booted up and get married. And we're going to have, like, Sunday, like, brunch dates. And she gets to come and, like, talk with the gays and stuff. Like, she's all about the life. And I can't.
Moms do that. Like, my mom, like, yeah, it wasn't the smoothest thing at first. But now it's, like, she's got, like, a gay son. And that's, like, she feels really, like, cool to have a gay son.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's, look at our day and age, like, everything that's really, like, popping off right now is somebody that's queer, trans, like, out of the norm,
it's a moment.
Gays, we're really making it happen, and even the people that are, like, speaking in, like, unison with us, like, at this point, that are, like, you know, at least speaking, like, the real truths about things, like, those people have something queer about them, or, like, something that the world doesn't actually accept,
right? You
know? So it's only natural.
Because, I don't know, I sort of feel this way. Do you feel like queer means almost, like, it's more than just sexuality?
Yeah, definitely.
It's like a whole, like, way of just, like, approaching life in kind of, like, a new way, maybe. I don't know.
No, you're totally right.
I feel like I've heard other people talk on that in, like,
queer, the first time I heard it, like, I took it to its most, like, literal meaning. It's something that people may not find, you know,
the original definition.
Normal, or, you know, it's just off. Like, something's off. Like, people don't understand. It's not meant to be understood. You know what I mean? Understood. Like, it's like, it's done. You know, it's like, it's just, it is what it is. We don't understand it, but let it be. That's kind of where I got it from. But, like, even now, when I think of, when someone says queer, I think of, okay, yes, we have our homosexual people. But then there's also those people that are just, like, just in their mindset. They're really, like, different. And they see, like, I think of, like, some of my friends are, like, pansexual.
Sure.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, even bisexuals, like, I know a lot of people hate on bisexuals, but, you know, that's, you know, like, that's just, maybe it's not all sex. Like, maybe it really is just love, or maybe it's, like, maybe it's an attraction factor, or maybe it's something deep down that we may not even understand, but we shouldn't, like, hate on it. We should respect it and just be like, okay, yeah, here we go, sure. You know? That's what they want to do with their lives. Make it happen.
But yes. Like, I think it's really harder to be bisexual than it is, especially as a man. I think, than to just be, like, a gay dude, do you think? What are your thoughts on that?
I feel like these days, being bisexual is, like, no big deal.
Yeah.
Like, at all.
I mean, ultimately, yeah, we're kind of at that point.
It's
kind of
like, no, like, no one at this point is really going to care if some girl's making out with another girl, like, at a party. Or
That's 100% true.
And then it's like, it's, when you're in places like our places, like in Los Angeles, like, yeah, there's places you can go where somebody might want to beat you up, or somebody might want to, like, call you an ill name or something like that. But I'm like, bring it on. Like,
right.
I'm 28. Like, I've been in a couple fights in my life. Like, if you want to get down with the get down, then let's get down with the get down. Like, that's just, that's a natural way of life. And I think anybody that's actually to a point to hate that much now, they're like, you know, queer, gay, or something themselves. Like, they're battling something deep inside. Like, now at this time in the world, anyone that has this much hate, they're battling something inside themselves.
It's so true. You see that.
And like, we're the people who are actually like trying to embody the change in the world. We're the ones that are trying to be the pioneers. So if someone's hating on that, then it's like, okay, you're stuck in the past. Mm-hmm. You're stuck in a place that's gonna eventually just wander off and disappear.
It's true.
So, and the rest of us are gonna be living long and, you know, skin on fleek, nails on fleek, hair on fleek.
Being our most real selves.
Yeah, just handling it. So.
True. So now you are like a huge anime fan.
Oh,
huge anime fan. And I think a lot of people would not see a correlation between.
As I'm wearing like Japanese characters.
Oh yeah, what do you know what that says? I have no idea.
I think it says like well behaved or something like that.
Oh my gosh.
My old job yet.
I feel like I see anime and video games and manga and all that type of stuff. It's really has a big influence on some of the LA club culture.
Yeah.
I mean, you...
You know what's funny? I went to Tokyo B in Little Tokyo, like, the night before last, and it was a juke party. Like, if you know, like, the kind of music that's juke, like, boom, 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 like, really hard and, like, jungly and, like...
Where did that come from? Where's the origin?
Chicago.
Okay.
Yeah, and it was actually a Chicago DJ, I think it was DJ Rashad, that started the whole, like, footwork, dance, and juke, like, movement, at least what it is today. Yeah, it's saying it's, like, right here, so you have to turn left or, like, right, and it's, like, a test, or is, yeah, probably. But in any case.
That strategy guide is 20 years old.
This is, like, right, maybe to the right, huh?
I'm not picking up on anything here. Tunnel armor. That's... And then this says door to the world.
Yeah, that's the door right there. So
oh, wait. I wonder if this is... I don't know. That is weird that that says that, but it's not there. And there's that one there, and there's that one, too. I haven't gotten to that, but yeah. Tunnel armor.
So it's right there.
I have no idea what's going on. Maybe I need to check back, because I know there's two parts of this game. There's a world of balance and a world of ruin.
Oh, look at that.
It's all good, though, because... You get experience.
Right.
But anyway, you were at the juke party in Little Tokyo.
And as I was there, like, adorned in, like, my favorite, like, sweater, like, I was wearing my rituals and just, like, this, like, witch house band.
Okay.
And it's, like, an upside-down cross, and it has rituals spelt in katakana. So it's, like, real cute. Like, everybody was giving that vibe, but then I'm, like, looking around, and there's people that are wearing, like, old school, like, anime shirts, like, you know, those, like, printed, like, button-up tees, and, like, the ones that have, like, Samurai X or, like, Girl in the Kitchen on it, and then, like, some guy was wearing, like, a Tenjo Tenge, like, character, like, I think it was, like, the main chick that turned into, like, the little chibi version and, like, the big version, and, like, on his shirt, and I was just like, why is everybody so down? And I know we're in Little Tokyo, and that seems a little cliche, like, you know, but, like, these is like hardcore like dancers and DJs, like we're talking 20s
yeah,
and
a real deal.
That are like out here making this money and doing the damn thing, and this is like a part of their culture. You know what I mean? And like people are like eating ramen balls at the bar. I like had a matcha green tea and a Sapporo, like I was like getting my life, you know? And so it just was so cool to see everybody like into the vibe, and like people are like coming over like, oh man, you're so cute. Like look at your shoes, look at this, look at that, you know, I'm like wearing my dagger earring and like, you know, giving looks. And, like this girl, she had on like these capsule earrings that I got from like Popular, I had the same ones, and then she had like these like metal bars, and she was really giving you like Akira, you know,
yes.
Like she was really giving that like that look, and I was just like, damn, like she's out here. And then next thing you know, she jumps into the circle and starts like doing this whole footwork thing with all of it. And I'm just like, no, this is deep, like, you know. And then like even the guy on the mic got and was like, you know, this little Chicago to LA thing, like this movement, like this is a people, it's creation, everyone has something that's in their pot. And it was like really deep. And you know, and like even now, like as I'm like looking over like social media, like talking to people about it, like anime and like even like anything Japanese culture, anything like game culture, like it's starting to become like an integral part of everything, because like we're just in an electronic world, like naturally people, you know, some people go home and they play PS4 the rest of their days, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
may not necessarily be Final Fantasy, maybe it's something else, but you're always going to hit that catch in, and there's going to be something that hooks them in, like You can't tell me right now one person that doesn't know Sailor Moon, you know, or like Sailor Moon Crystal came out, like everybody's gagging over it. And so you know, everybody's on Hulu watching anime, everyone's on Crunchyroll watching anime, like everyone's like watching a series a week. Like it just comes, you know. Some people have to watch it dubbed, but you know, it is what it is. Like now it's something that's like almost conformed, if you will. Like
it's true.
Hardcore, but I still think I'm cool when it comes to
anime. No, you are cool. I mean, it's like, and I'm like, Kalela's had that video, The Message, where it's like,
oh, Kalela?
Yeah, anime.
Type but of she's, a vibe. Wait a minute now, like, and I've met her, like, she's pretty down with the underground, and even the whole Fade to Mine crew, they're like radical nerds. Like,
oh, I would never say otherwise.
Like, oh my god, like, Prince Willy, especially, like, he's always like into that, like, like something that like makes them like, you know, kind of nerdy or like they're about it. And if you think about their music, a lot of the stuff that they like produce, like you're gonna hear stuff like that over in like Japan. Mm-hmm. You know, they've been like having stuff like that. Like, that's why they're international, you know. So I can't, you know, I can't say she didn't have a background.
No, I'm not saying that. She's totally in it. I mean, I remember I was hanging out with this guy, and he was like a total nerdy type guy, like. Like, you know, like, I think we might have even been, like, in a khaki cargo shorts type situation. Ooh. Real smart, though. Like, just not really giving you a look, but, like, really smart. And he was like, do you want to go to this party later? It's, run by my friend, Prince William.
And I was like,
oh, that's really cool that, because, you know, usually you think about, like, club DJs or whatever, different people being very image-focused, image-conscious.
Yeah, whatever. Kinda.
You know what I mean? No, you don't feel it. I mean, I feel I like, feel let's that. Let's break down the stereotypes
that's
here.
That's so, I mean, especially, like, someone who's seen a nightlife, like a socialite, if you will, right? Like a fashionista, or you're a photographer, or you're a DJ, or you're something, you're a promoter, whatever. Mm-hmm. You have to be willing to put yourself into the public eye. That is the number one requirement. Like, you have to be able to jump into the crowd, meet everyone, and invite them to the party, or, you know, talk to them about the music, or, you know, just be whatever. So with that, you would think comes the context of, like, being a nice person or being sociable. No, you don't have to do that, okay? So know that when some DJs are assholes, they really are just assholes.
Yeah.
But they, you know, they don't appreciate the people that are doing the music, whatever. That's how they do. But any good DJ, any good socialite, any good anybody has all these social ties with people who are really cool, who come out to the party, who want to be, you know, like, supportive, and those people will create networks and networks and networks of other people that are like that. Mm-hmm. It's like, anybody that has that many networks connected to them is going to fall into style, because you're going to be surrounded constantly by people who are, like, you know, mm-hmm. you know, out and giving their own sense of style or their own sense of person and very, you know, their own aesthetic, right?
Yeah.
So you're gonna catch on to these things and maybe be like, oh, I like how she's wearing that. Oh, I like how he's wearing that. Oh, dang, man, that shirt's really dope. Let me go over to that store and get one of those shirts. You know, like, stuff like that happens, and next thing you know, like, you get an image, you have a look, or you get set into, like, you know, your persona, right? Mm-hmm. Whoever you are. You know, Mr. Photographer, he always has his camera on him.
Sure.
Besides that, maybe he has, like, a Lucky Rabbit sweater or something, or maybe he always wears, like, a leather cap. Or maybe sure. he's always wearing shades of black or monochrome gray or something, you know, something rather, you know, crazy. But there's always something about that person that's tied into those networks that's going to, like, be caught on by other people. Because when they're in the public eye, that's the first thing that they're bringing out. That's the first thing, like, me, myself, like, I like having my personality and my fashion, like, speak for myself. So naturally, people are coming up to me and they're like, oh, he's tall, oh my goodness. Oh, I heard him laughing, he's funny. You know, ooh, he's got cute clothes on, ooh. Great, stuff like that, you know, great. And then they come up to me with that prerequisite, and then I come in with the charm and glamour and, you know, whatever, and that's my persona, that's who I am, that's who I want to represent, you know, that's who I am. You know, anybody else, like you, like, you know, you personify your podcast, your gamer life, your anime life, your constant nerdism. That's something that you naturally give up, like, when you hop into the social eye, and you're not afraid. You know, that fear of being judged by other people in the social eye is what creates all those stigmas. All those, like, things that, like, people start making, like, oh, well, he's this, or, oh, she's that. It's just because they have that fear of not being able to accept that, or, like, see it, or they're shielding something. It's always somebody else's problem, I like to say. But that's what creates all the stigma. So even as DJs, like, you know, you get a lot of that. Like, I know people think I'm just, like, this, like, raging, like, party monster.
Party animal, yeah.
No way. Like, you know, like, I love sleep.
Yes.
I love being at home and playing video games. Yes, yes. So, you know, when I am out, like, don't be surprised if I'm leaving at, like, 1:59, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like, cutting that last track off at 1:50, because sometimes it bees like that.
Yeah.
So, and that just goes to show, like, you know, you should just be outward with who you are and what you're about. And that way everybody will just accept you. But then, again, that's what builds up that to be in public, in social life, you know, like,
yeah.
Be able to be a public speaker, be a leader, or whatever, you know. It just comes natural for some people.
And fashion, you're saying, is sort of an inevitability.
Well, I've always been kind of fashionable. Mm-hmm. My mom always had me, like, in the flyest dress and stuff.
Yeah.
So did my dad, you know, fresh haircut, whatever. But I think as of late, like, I'm all about basics again. Like, I don't really, I just layer up a whole bunch of stuff. Mm-hmm. You know what's actually really nerdy of me, and I can admit it, especially on like a show like this.
Oh, yeah. That's
one good. Of my biggest fashion, like, icons and, like, inspirations on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. Okay, Marvel vs. Capcom 2.
Yes.
Hayato.
Yes, absolutely.
When you press, I think it's R1 will do it, the all black.
Yes.
So he has like the crop top that's like sleeveless and has like the like abrasions to it.
Is there a little belly like, out on that look?
Yeah, but he's wearing a like a skin or like
some kind of like, spandex, some kind of, like, spandex thing
on the bottom. Then he's wearing the same thing when it comes to his pants, but they're almost like tights because he needs like the movement. Then he has the double belt, his pant loop has belt, then he has his utility belt on. Inspiration. I'm constantly like wearing like just layering a black, like my long sleeve shirts, then something cropped or sleeve on top. Then I'm always about like my like the belt or something hanging off in the size where like my tail or my bag and stuff like that. Like it's those little things, but like inspiration. See, that was totally nerdy, but
no, it's
real. I feel
real.
Someone will appreciate it.
And not all DJs, I mean there are some mean DJs, but I think some DJs are just shy. Like I know our friend Rudy, he told me that he started DJing because he didn't want to have to talk to people at the party.
Oh my gosh.
That was his.
But Rudy loves to talk to people.
I know, so he does, yeah.
That's big anyway.
He's the best. Shout out to Rudy, shout out to Maritone Collective.
Yes, the booze and
doing
the bass.
Doing it.
We should all have brunch soon.
Literally one of the, like, how can I put it? Like, you know there's like gay cliques, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And like, I would say though like that they're like
the cliques in anything like
there is, but I personally found like the way that those guys all genuinely care about each other and their friends and like the people in their lives is just very inspirational to me.
Man, fuck that.
What?
I'm just kidding. No, I'm just kidding. I was gonna be like, Carlos is rude.
Well,
hi,
yeah.
Hi.
How's it going?
No, he's not rude. He's just.
But I mean. I mean, like, with each, I don't know, like, sometimes I feel like some of the gay guy cliques, they're just friends with each other for, like, the sakes of,
perks
the, like,
and stuff. And
yeah, the status, or I don't even really know
what it is.
I
always feel like
is.
Those ones are the ones that are fucking each other. That's what I like to say. Like,
yeah.
The ones that have those kind of, like, uncohesive, but cohesive, like, cliques and whatnot. I'm like, those are the ones that are being whores with each other.
Okay, but how do you feel about having sex with your friends? What's your opinion on that?
I have about one friend that I've known for years that I would want to fuck right now. Otherwise, no.
You try to keep those gay guy friends out of the boat.
I try to stay out of the circle, actually. Because as I am tied to all of these networks of people, I am also tied into everybody's ex or everybody's whoever, everybody's whatever. And so I, like, honestly like to kind of just, like, steer clear. Like, there's... In my last, like, 5 years in the friendships and the big circles I have now, there's probably about, like, 3 or 4 people that I even, like, considered hooking up with. And to this day, it has not happened.
Yeah.
I'm very, like... I'm not gonna say I'm, like, sheltered or, like, you know,
sectioned off. No, it's smart.
When
it's
it comes
wise.
To, like, yeah, when it comes to, like, those, like, specific groups, I'm like, no. Like, I'm just gonna steer clear. So.
Yeah.
And, like, any of, like, my best friends that I consider, like, family, like, my sisters, oh, no. No way.
No way. Yeah.
Like, it just can't happen.
I mean, true confession, I was going out with this guy, everything was going really nice, and then it was, like, basically turned out that we had dated, like, two of the same old people, that, like, Matt, you know, whatever. Uh-huh. And it was just too weird. It was just too weird. It was, like, because I was, like, or wasn't really even that. It was, like, I dated this one guy and I was friends with this other guy. Uh-huh. Was what it was. And it was, like, it was just, it couldn't happen.
Wow.
Because, like, we were constantly thinking about those past relationships and, like, the way they had... I mean, like, you want to be, like, mature and not let those things... You want to be mature, but you can't always be mature, you know? You have to, like, give yourself that.
You don't have to be mature in those situations.
Right.
Those are one of those situations where we kind of just go, oh, okay, yeah, we know. But it's just another reason to steer clear.
Steer clear.
I've been in a very long relationship. I'm talking a good 28 years with food.
Sure.
And it's going so strong.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Like,
yes.
Whenever I feel like I'm alone in the world, I know that vanilla ice cream is going to be ready for me.
Yeah.
You know?
Sure.
Tuna salad sandwich is going to be, like, on point. You know what I mean? Like, it's going to, like, give me that love and that feel, that fullness.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
And they say you get a lot of the same feelings from sex and love and all that type of stuff.
You know what?
Chocolate.
Sex is like the equivalent to like sweets. Like it's pretty much like, you know, something you should give up every now and then.
I hear you. Now,
every now and then.
Do you get real like decadent with it? Like, do you go get like some really nice piece of food? Tell me what those are. Tell me about that.
Oh my god. I'm the worst because I like to cook, like, really sweet things and, like, really bomb everything.
Mm-hmm.
Like, lately I've been making, like, cinnamon brown sugar waffles with, like, Mexican tequila, which has kind of, like, Mexican vanilla.
Whoa!
Mexican vanilla, which has tequila in it.
Okay.
So it's, like, vanilla extract, but it has, like, tequila in it, and it's, like, pretty real. And then I'll, like, put brown sugar, and then I'll put that in a bowl, and then cover it with, like, ice cream. Like,
yeah.
Do, like, double vanilla, or, like, hazelnut marzipan, like those private selections from like Ralph's and stuff, because I love those ones.
Mm-hmm.
They have a baklava one on point. And I'll like eat that with like syrup and like chocolate syrup and whipped cream like all on top of it. Like that's my end all and end all. Or I'll like just make a really bomb like something to eat. Like, you know what I mean? Like it's bad enough like I live right next to like a Whole Foods and I'll just go.
Oh, you do? You're that little spot away. Oh, okay.
Yeah. So it's like, no, I'll just go and like get something and just make something, or like I'll make a pizza or like something on point and just eat it, and all those feelings will just go away.
Oh yeah. Well, because I mean it's also a thing, especially because what you're describing is you're not just eating, you're making it for yourself, right?
Yeah. Oh yeah, it's like putting all that energy into it.
And no
like,
one can give, this is Martha Stewart truism, no one can give you that satisfaction. Well, here, let's get some shade out on Martha Stewart.
I mean, I think she had a lot going on in her life, but she didn't have to shit on everybody like that.
Who did she shit on?
Like,
I don't even know this drama.
Like, she's...
Oh, they're
she's
stolen.
The original. She's like the original, like, you know, cookstress, like Rachel Ray, all these, like, naked chefs and shit like that. Yeah, that's cute or whatever, but, like, Martha Stewart made it happen.
Oh, so you're pro Martha. I'm pro Martha
Just
Stewart,
too.
Just
because she got caught up doesn't mean she's any less people.
Yeah,
like,
she's good. No, she's good. And what she always says is, no one can give you the satisfaction of making that whatever, you know, baking that cake,
yeah,
making those cupcakes that you will get from doing it yourself. And that's what you're doing
when
you're making these beautiful creations.
You're making it happen. And yeah, and that's good. You know, I'm not saying I'll go out be a hoe like everyone else, but it's like, you know, like that'll suffice rather than like an actual relationship, like a real relationship. Oh no, it's been 9 years now.
Mm-hmm.
Like real, like I don't even bother.
Well, it's not a horrible way to go in these scenes, because I read this Rick Owens interview. It was a little damaging. Because he was basically saying, like, he felt like he had to, like, get, like, I mean, I'm not quite as far as he's going with it, but he basically said he had to go and get married because he was going out to the club or the whatever or the fashion situation.
He couldn't keep his dick together.
He couldn't keep his dick together, and it was awkward. He was like all these creative people that he wanted to work with, and you know, it is sexy when people are talented.
As soon as you start working with them, they're ready to fucking smash. Like, yeah. That's just how it goes.
And then you do, and then it gets weird. Yeah. It gets awkward. Yeah. So it's not good it could be worse, you know.
I think people just need to catch a grip. We're all adults. We're trying to be, at least.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to fuck somebody, fuck somebody. But if you want to run a business with somebody, run a fucking business.
And don't have sex. Don't get into that.
Don't shit where you eat. You know better. Like, you know better. I just got out of a company that was, like, all about that life. Like, fucking.
Oh, really?
Managers were fucking people.
No way.
That's, like, in the 5 years we worked for. Or, yeah. And I never. Like, even as I became a manager, I never. Like, I think there was probably 2 people that I ever, like, worked with that I was down for. And, like, one of them is, like, now my friend of 5 years. And the other one is, like, I'll text him right now and just say what's up. And that's it. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I never actually did it. Like, I wasn't down. You know what I mean? Like, that's just, it's real.
Pardon my rudeness. I'm just going to send out a little text here. So, may we know what company that is, or are we going to keep that on the
table for today? H&M.
Oh, H&M, okay.
Yeah, I worked for H&M for 5 years.
Oh my gosh.
All kinds of.
And you were the manager of the store.
All kinds of hushing. Not the entire store, like, I was just supervisor.
Supervisor, sure, but you saw, you know.
Yeah. Well, that's where I was at. Might as well have been the store manager, but.
Yes.
Yeah, I recently just quit because
it was way too much.
It got real.
That's that's like a breakup in itself, going from breaking up with a 5-year job.
Yeah, I mean, I think even it's been 2 months already.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, I quit, so I didn't claim unemployment. Like, I like just had my saved money.
That's good.
Moved in with a friend, like just took, I literally took a month to just sleep. Like, sleep. All of the end of December and just like, almost now, like, I probably slept, like, maybe a good 9 hours a day, like, at least. Like, just catching up.
That is nice.
Like, you know what I mean? And, like, I've been eating better. I've been, like, still trying to get some exercise. I've been, like, doing the parties and stuff and not drinking as much. And, like, just really just focusing on myself and my happiness. And I've, like, been booking out these gigs. Like, I just booked the Regent for the day before Valentine's Day, like, the Saturday. I'm going to be opening for Crystal Waters. Like,
wow, that is such a dream come true.
And it's me and, like, some of my, like, most favorite DJs I've ever played with. Like, Chelsea, like, they're all, like, people I've, like, come to know, like, in all this, you know? And, like, even between that, like, having that job didn't halter any of that, but it was just, like, I was always just so stressed out and, like, angry and stuff, and, like, I was stressing myself sick at this point, like, you know what I mean? Like, so I had to just quit for myself, and since then, it's, like, it's been so good. Like, so good. So. Ooh, even I buzz it now. Let's see.
We're all fired up.
Ooh. Who that is?
Who's trying to get at me?
It's my friend Lewis. He's just messy, that's all. Oh, and then my new neighbor. Hey. So I met this guy.
Okay.
That lives up the street from me. He just moved here from Fresno. His
okay.
His name's Isaac. He's so cool.
Uh-huh.
He's so cool. And so he was like, I'm in downtown. Where are you? Are you gonna go hang out?
So what are we supposed to do next? What are we supposed to do? We're in March. We're in South Figaro. We got through the cave of South Figaro. What is it telling us to do? What do we do?
The city. You're supposed to... Cafe House. Mr. Kolts. You did that, I think.
Yeah, in the cafe.
Yo, Cross Shadow. Did that already. Mount Kolts. That's next.
Okay.
So you went to the little house where you are right now.
Yeah,
as you move about the cabin, you'll notice that Edgar recognizes some of Savin's favorite things. Obviously, Savin has been here. Use the beds to get all your strength. You'll need it for the battle ahead. And then, yeah, you're supposed to exit and head into Mount Kolts. To the east of South Figaro rises Mount Kolts, where the martial arts master, Duncan, teaches his students. Here you'll find Edgar's brother, Savin, and engage Varius in a duel to the finish. In many ways, this will be your first true test.
Yeah.
Shit's getting real, bruh.
Shit's getting real.
And the mountain is real serious. There's all kinds of catchy little items.
Okay.
There's a guardian, an atlas armlet, a tent. 7 joins your party, and then you get another tent. How fun.
Let's get into that here. Where is the mountain? Close.
Oh my gosh. You're gonna be fighting all kinds of crazy monsters. Let's see. That Vargas guy is pretty serious.
No, yeah, this is like the first real like boss of the game, I would
He's
say.
He's like freaking
ripped.
Like monster, yeah. He's like super demon size. I was like, is that Ifrit? Could've fooled me.
Not quite yet, I guess. That is one of the things I wish you got in the summons a little faster in this game.
Well, I mean, you know how they do.
Yeah.
They want you to rely on your true strength.
They want you to really learn how to do it. Okay. Maybe go Bio Blast, Noise Blaster first.
Ooh.
Then I'll just focus on one dude.
I always laugh how like the monsters are like such a different degree like to the character.
Oh yeah, he's like, looking totally different.
Yeah.
So,
it's like poison, right? Oh, you gave him life! Oh my gosh.
Oh, that's not good. Okay, goodness that's me. Good to remember. Those people are healed by poison.
Goodness me.
I like healed back all the damage he had gone and done to himself.
There you go.
I like these hasty little boots I'm wearing here.
Right.
What are we getting into here?
Let's see. Most of your items are like on the hedges, like outside of the cave. The inside of the cave is just like monsters, and that's it.
I see.
There's only the Atlas Armlet, which is like next to like a little waterfall. Mm-hmm. And that's it. What the hell is that?
That?
Like a woolly mammoth.
This thing is so crazy because if I can't attack, it's doing this weird thing where if I try to attack something and it won't let me, I basically know that it's gonna die on the next hit. You know
oh, wow.
It's giving me like a weird little tip. Little head of the curve moment. So going back to some of those earlier topics, you knew you were gay when you were a little kid, but when were you first in an environment where you could truly express yourself and express all that, all those feelings?
Well, and even as like a few of my like actual like high school friends that I still have, like it's been 10 years already.
Crazy.
Like I talk to them like ever so often. And the one who like really like stands to his name's Andres, he's always like, no, I knew you were gay. And I, you know, he always like claims that I was like lying about like all the like having sex with girls story and stuff like that.
But that really did happen.
It happened, yes, sadly. Oh. But it was like, you know, I always like he always knew I was like gay. He always knew. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, people at school knew. It wasn't a big deal. But I came out on graduation day. Like, I told all
to
of my
it,
friends.
Huh?
And so, even at all of that, like, and we don't even talk about, like, the friends who are, like, on Facebook and don't really comment or anything. Because that's whatever. Mm-hmm. But I'm talking, like, the honest to God friends that I had that were, like, you know, down for me. Like, a few of them, like, just disappeared. Like I was best friends with the valedictorian at our school, and like, I haven't talked to him since graduation.
So he was the valedictorian, but he still wasn't smart enough to accept
well,
you?
Well, his father was a pastor, and, like, it was, like, just one of those things,
yeah.
So, and, like, you know when rumors circulate, like, when people hang out, I always, like, spend a lot of time with them and stuff, like, I never, like, you know, did anything like that. But
his basic you're saying the paranoia was that he was, like, hooking up with you.
Yeah, or some shit like that.
Like, that's what he was worried,
about least,
what people
at least
think.
That's how I felt it was at that time,
yeah.
You know? That was here shy of 10 years ago, so whatever. Mm-hmm. But even after graduation day, so I went to Cal State Long Beach,
mm-hmm.
and that was like my first excursion into college. And of course, like first day, I was like doing a trade, like, you know, gay, like, yes, I am gay, like, I'm gay, and mm-hmm. that might even be half the reason why I didn't make it through college, because I was just too busy like promoting myself and like trying to like be like this person that I thought I had to be. And it's like I had all these friends who would like take me to parties and like all this other stuff, you know, but it's like it wasn't really like that wasn't the point. The point was like, okay, what am I gonna do to to like be gay. Like, what does it mean to me to be gay? Like, what, you know,
have to figure that out for yourself. It's not easy.
So of course for me it was butt sex. Like, I should be having lots and lots of butt sex. Sure. So I ended up like getting together with this kid off MySpace, and he literally was a kid. Like, I, like, on MySpace he was 19, but by the time we broke up and I found out the real day, he was like 16.
That.
So it was pretty real, and that was like a deep excursion into my life, because I was only 17. I thought he was older than me, and
well, school, yeah, and you were only 17. So
yeah, I started college like
really young,
like really young, and like I turned 18 when I was in my first year of college. Like, you know what I mean? So that just for me was pretty deep, and like even just getting with him and like having sex with him and like all this other stuff, that was like a pretty big deal. And I still lived in like LA, but I was always out, because you know, once high school was over, it was like I wasn't even, you know, concerned about being home at whatever hour.
Yeah.
You know, like I was just living my life, and even when I would sneak out when I was in high school, it was like, you know, at that time I didn't have much supervision, so I was just like living my life. Like, I was always going to like the Rocky Horror Picture Show, like on 4th Street in Long Beach, and like meeting all these guys, and ending up in all these like crazy orgies and shit, and like, you know, like just all that random shit that you do when you're a fucking kid. So like, it's just, even now just thinking about it, I guess that really was like when I started doing like the gay things for myself and becoming like that person, you know. Like, it didn't happen overnight, definitely, but I felt like the change was definitely like, you know, to that level. That's the Atlas thing.
Oh yeah, let's get that things.
Yeah, thought it was a waterfall, but it's a ray of light.
Yeah, I'm so glad I came out in 9th grade in a way, and also because...
But people were down.
People were so down because I was at this hippie boarding school.
See, like, that's
if,
cool.
If you know something about, sort of that life, they're very, very open to all the gay stuff.
Yeah.
But they're also, sort of, there's not a lot of gay guys, I feel. There's all lesbians and women sort of experimenting with that stuff, but not as many. It's not as easy for the guys to be open. So like, when you become open as a gay guy, you're just like so, like embraced. Accepted. You're like, it's a, you're almost like too embraced. You're too
like,
embraced.
Oh my God,
I feel like I was maybe too embraced. Like, I remember being like in class, because I was doing the same thing you were doing. I was knocking off my schoolwork.
Yeah.
To be doing that gay whatever, yeah, stuff I was doing. Not even in a sexual way, but just, you know, just the event of, like, people finding out and knowing. Because I orchestrated that shit so crazy. Like, I told people, like, I would tell... The first person I told was, like, this super nerdy kid from Alaska who I just knew wouldn't give a fuck. He wasn't even my best friend or close friend, but I just knew he wouldn't... Like, it wasn't that he would... I just
Come
knew he wouldn't
Alaska.
Care either way. And I was just, like, sitting there playing his, like, little Red Alert, Command and Conquer, whatever. And I'm like... I've got to tell you this, I'm gay, or I think I said I was bisexual at the time, but that didn't last long. That lasted about a week. And he was just like, okay, and he's just like keeping on going. So I basically told everyone in the school, because it's a small school, there's like 100 kids in my grade. Until
100 kids in my class!
Right. And so I told each person that I thought was like the least homophobic until... And I also was like, don't tell anyone. And of course, some of them did, but it was still like...
They're like, oh my God,
Johnny's
such a faggot.
So, right, exactly. And so by the time I got to the homophobic people, there was already this whole... They were in the minority.
Wave of people.
They were in the minority. But anyway. Well, Will, I feel like we just cracked the surface here on The Life Story. I'm going to have you back on the show.
Clearly.
On the podcast.
I'll talk about myself forever.
Because I loved it. We got so many good stories. And you're just so fun.
Yeah, and you're like steadily leveling up the whole time.
Yeah, and I'm just taking my time, getting all my little pieces of equipment,
you're still
everything
like
I need.
You're missing some
of the items. We're gonna go back through it.
I'm like, anyone that has a strategy guide, you're like required to be like 115% into the game.
You do have to.
By the time I come back, I expect to see like level 50.
We're gonna be like
yeah, everyone needs glistening. To be buffed. There needs to be like 20 different characters for you to choose from.
Oh my gosh.
All of it.
Yes. Well, you're gonna come back.
I'm down.
This is a 60-hour game, so there's time.
I'm down, and I'll even like get a crack at it.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. I'm into that. We could trade up for a minute.
Yeah. I'm totally
yeah.
Down.
Absolutely.
Totally down.
All right. Thank you so much, Will. This has been another episode of Let's Play. Let's Gay. Final Fantasy VI.